Good afternoon, good evening, good morning. It is our great honor to welcome so many music professionals and decision makers from around the world joining today's edition of Resetting the Stage. Resetting the Stage is a global online conference series exploring dynamic challenges and opportunities faced by arts sector professionals. Each conversation convenes a diverse group of industry experts, including public officials, managers, presenters, board members, and other decision makers, who navigate complex questions and examine the evolving landscape of the future of performance. Season 2 widens the conversation, encourages greater participation, and extends the reach to include the voice of more communities around the world, including the addition of simulcast audio translation of all sessions to English and Spanish, and a special add-on entitled Resetting the Stage Enfoque Colombia that, following each global discussion, allows experts from Colombia and across Latin America to adapt ideas raised to the region's unique realities. We are thrilled to have you join us today by participating, exchanging, and discussing in these interactive cross-sector and cross-continental conversations to make sense of a performing arts world in transformation. The Global Leaders Program offers an Ivy League curated executive graduate certificate in social entrepreneurship and cultural agency. Each year, 60 music professionals distinguished by proven accomplishments and a persevering commitment to create change become part of an international cohort. Led in partnership with 9 top universities, among them Harvard, Duke, Georgetown, NYU, and McGill, the Global Leaders Program's faculty includes Nobel Prize recipients, Grammy winners, and TED presenters. The Spanish Association of Symphony Orchestras, AEOS, is a non-profit association which brings together 35 symphony orchestras from Spain and Portugal. The Spanish Association of Symphony Orchestras has the aim of promoting and developing a range of initiatives to encourage cooperation of its member orchestras, in addition to providing a place where people can meet, exchange information, and train. Classical Next is the global gathering for all art music professionals. Representatives from all sectors are offered a place to meet and connect, do business, brainstorm, create and be inspired. Artists, managers, presenters, orchestras, labels, educators, members of the press, and more come together each year at the annual event, as well as online throughout the year. Through its international network of professionals, Classical Next helps the global scene collectively optimize what the art music form is and can be. In addition to designing and implementing Colombia's monetary policy, Banco de la República, Colombia's central bank, runs a 29-city countrywide network of cultural centers, libraries, and archaeological and art museums. The bank hosts Colombia's preeminent annual chamber music season. Its main recital hall is located in Bogotá and is well known for its award-winning architecture, impressive acoustics, and enthusiastic audiences. Before introducing today's distinguished speakers, I would like to share brief housekeeping requests to help make today's session more interactive and engaging for all of you. At the bottom of the screen, you'll see a control panel with the chat. Please go over now and write your name, country of residence, and your organization. In the control panel, you will also find a Q&A button. You are encouraged to engage directly with our panelists by posing a question for them in this Q&A box. Please submit your questions as early as possible, as there will be a limit to how many can be answered during the session. Real-time interpretation of our sessions is provided. You can choose your preferred language in the interpretation section of your control panel. Today's global session will be followed by a second panel discussion focused on adapting today's themes to the context of the arts sector in the Ibero-Americas. This Spanish session will begin 15 minutes after the conclusion of today's global session and will last for 45 minutes. We encourage those of you interested in the region to stay for the break and join this special Latin America-themed debrief conversation co-presented in alliance with our partner, Fundación Bolívar da Vivienda. Finally, at the close of today's global session, you'll be prompted to complete a brief survey that will appear on your screens. We kindly ask you that you share constructive feedback or suggestions for future sessions as we continue to evolve this growing series to address topics and challenges of relevance to all of you working in the sector around the world. And with that, let's get started. Welcome to today's edition of Resetting the Stage Season 2. Today's session is entitled Public Investment for Public Good, Rethinking Philanthropy and Social Impact. It's great to see so many professionals of different fields joining us today from around the world. In today's edition of Resetting the Stage, as private investment in public good evolves from the once siloed pursuit of philanthropic individuals and corporations to an integral part of sustainable community ecosystems, a panel of leading decision makers explores innovative lessons and learnings being applied to the forefront of the social impact field. It is my distinct honor to welcome our illustrious panelists. Karina Litvak. Following a 25-year career in finance, Karina serves on the boards of the Italian oil and gas major Eni, where she chairs the Sustainability and Scenarios Committee, Verdor Waste Management and KKR Portfolio Company, where she chairs the Board of Sustainability Committee, the CFA Institute and Business for Social Responsibility, a consultant specializing in sustainable business practice. Since the passage of the Paris Agreement at the UN Climate Change Conference in 2015, Karina has been working to build a global network for fellow board members to drive more effective climate transition strategies in the boardroom. Under the auspices of the World Economic Forum, she co-founded the Climate Governance Initiative and has been working to build a global network of national chapters for directors. She is an executive board director of Chapter Zero and serves on the senior advisory panel of oil and mining consultant Critical Resource and the Advisory Council of Transparency International UK. Leslie Masdorp is vice president and chief financial officer of the New Development Bank, a development finance institution for emerging markets. Over the past 25 years, he has occupied senior leadership roles in both private and public sectors. Most recently, he served as a managing director and president of Bank of the America Merrill Lynch for Southern Africa. Prior to that, he served in a dual role as vice chairman of Barclays Capital and APSA Capital. In 2002, he was the first African to be appointed as international advisor to Goldman Sachs International. During his early career, Leslie served in several senior leadership roles in the government of South Africa, including leading the privatization of state-owned enterprises. Leslie is a young global leader of the World Economic Forum. Michael Zawi is an investment banker, a former vice chairman of Morgan Stanley, where he ran European M&A. He set up his advisory boutique, Zawi & Co. in 2012. Since inception, the firm has worked on over 200 billion mergers and acquisitions. Michael is actively involved with his alma mater, Harvard University. He served on the Harvard Business School Board of Dean's Advisors and is a member of the Balfour International Council at the Kennedy School of Government. He was also the founding chairman of the HBS European Council. Michael is a governor of the South Bank Center, which includes the Royal Festival Hall, the Queen Elizabeth Hall, and the Hayward Gallery. Born in Morocco, he was appointed in 2019 by His Majesty the King to the Commission for a New Model of Development. Michael has served as a member of the advisory board for the Global Leaders Program since 2017. Matthew Bishop is a visiting senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and a former managing director of the Rockefeller Foundation Bellagio Center on Lake Como, where he convened global leaders to work towards solving some of the world's biggest challenges. Matthew has an award-winning writer and editor at The Economist for over 25 years, including a decade as the magazine's New York bureau chief. Matthew is leading expert on how to reform capitalism to better serve all members of the society and was on the G8 Task Force on Impact Investing. Matthew is the co-author of Economics A to Z and Philanthrocapitalism, How Giving Can Save the World and the Road from Ruin, a New Capitalism for a Big Society.
He co-founded the Social Progress Index, an influential index of how well a society serves its citizens, and the Giving Tuesday movement, which uses social media to celebrate giving and drive more effective charity. He also co-founded 17 Rooms, an initiative created to work toward meeting the UN Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. He has made frequent appearances on NPR, BBC, and PBS, and other media outlets. Matthew was also honored by the World Economic Forum as Young Global Leader. Julia Müller has taken on various leadership roles at a number of major cultural institutions in Europe. For nearly a decade, she has been head of development and sponsoring of the Salzburg Festival in Austria, one of the world's most prominent cultural festivals that celebrated its centenary in 2020. Julia is credited for the founding and development of the Friends of the Salzburg Festival Next Generation. Prior to that, she was head of development at Elbphilharmonie and Leischhall in Hamburg, Germany. Jane Watson has more than 25 years experience as a senior executive, political advisor, and consultant. She was appointed CEO of the National Arts Center Foundation in 2009. The foundation has set record fundraising goals over the period of Ms. Watson's leadership and has championed and funded new initiatives such as the world's first National Indigenous Theater, NAC Orchestra Performance and Education Tours to China, the UK, and Europe, and the foundation's first ever multi-million dollar fundraising campaign, the Creation Campaign. Prior to joining the NAC, Ms. Watson served as the Director of Communications at Export Development Canada and held senior communications role in the Office of the Speaker of the House of Commons and Canada Post Corporation. She currently serves on the Governor General Performing Arts Awards Board and served as Governor of Ashbury College and Trustee of Queen's University. But first to begin, it is my pleasure to introduce today's moderator, Katia Gorbatyuk, to set the stage where our discussion begins. Katia has been leading a strategic joint venture for UK publicly traded company that is championing environmentally safe technologies in the oil and gas industry. Her early career includes 14 years in investment banking at Merrill Lynch, Credit Suisse, and Barclays, where she focused on emerging markets as well as managed new initiatives. She has been a long-standing board and committee member of high-impact nonprofit organizations, including the Global Leaders Program, London Music Fund, London Symphony Orchestra, Orchestra of the Americas, Carnegie Hall, Midori and Friends, and many others. She collaborated with the World Economic Forum, orchestrating its 40th anniversary celebration at Carnegie Hall. Katia is an active contributor to the UK Institute of Directors Centre for Corporate Governance and the chair of a working group focused on the role of boards in integrating stakeholder perspectives in governance. Once again, welcome all. Katia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much to everybody for being here today. And apologies for a small technical issue with Michael Zawi's camera. We're working on it right now in the background. So hopefully he will, everybody. Oh, here he is. Thank you for bearing with us, Michael. Thank you. So 50 years ago, a Nobel Prize winning economist, Milton Friedman, proclaimed that the only responsibility of businesses is to generate profits. And for decades to the present times, this view of the role of business was prevalent. Businesses were run mostly in the name of profit and stock price, while the consideration of the society declined. It became hard for companies to operate in a conscious way. Well before the pandemic, the single-minded focus of profits on profits was criticized for causing the degradation of nature and biodiversity and exacerbating economic inequality. Businesses were consuming resources faster than our planet could regenerate, and often success was achieved at the expense of the society. Thus, this model, when companies are focused only on maximizing profits without heart or conscience, has been proven to be unsustainable. With public funds depleted, governments alone will be unable to address today's pressing challenges, and they shouldn't. Over the recent years, we've seen the beginning of a truly global movement to proliferate social responsibility with the adoption of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals and the launch of global sustainability initiatives. This movement has attracted numerous enthusiasts from around the world, not only regulators and think tanks, but most importantly, global investors, finance intermediaries, and companies themselves. So steps are being made in the right direction. The United Nations Principles for Responsible Investment, the world's largest voluntary corporate sustainability initiative, now includes 7,000 corporate signatories in 135 countries. At the 2019 Business Roundtable, large companies expressed their commitment to sustainability by issuing a statement on the purpose of a corporation. The topic of corporate responsibility has been captioned under many names, such as strategic philanthropy, corporate citizenship, social investment, but regardless of the label, it is centered on the idea of creating shared value. And shared value means a more inclusive kind of progress with a positive contribution of business to the society, not when progress is in essence subsidized by the planet and people. Many companies donate money to causes that are intended to bring about social change. Close to 90% of large companies have reported to have social responsibility programs. And this number was around 20% just 10 years ago. Historically, much of the corporate giving happened without any direct involvement outside the funds offered. Often it was viewed as a marketing exercise, and the prevailing belief was that the company's only mandate is creating shareholder returns. But the magnitude of global challenges we're facing today calls for something different and bigger. 2020 alone has shown that getting involved proactively in resolving social issues goes to the heart of long-term viability of a business. So we're not here today to talk about corporate philanthropy, but rather a new and holistic role that businesses could play in their communities. So with that, I would like to turn to our first panelist, Karina Litvak, who in my mind is a champion of the sustainability agenda on boards. And I'd like to ask Karina to comment on the various forces behind today's drive for social awareness and responsibility. What brings this agenda to the forefront?
Well, thank you very much, Katya. I mean, you know, on one level, it's all of the things that you just listed, pressure from investors. I mean, I wouldn't be on the boards of two of my companies if it weren't for the fact that investors put me there. In the case of Eni, it's the investors who selected me and nominated me to the board. In the case of Viridor, it's KKR. So investors play a really pivotal role in introducing this concept into boardrooms. Now, they haven't always been successful, and I know this because I used to be an investor, and I would sometimes feel immense frustration in dialogues with companies who would say, you know, nobody else raises this question, you're the only ones, which I knew wasn't true because I had lots of colleagues in other investment firms who were raising the very same questions. But it wasn't yet, shall we say, you know, the bread and butter. It wasn't mainstream. That really changed in January of this year when Larry Fink of BlackRock came out with his usual annual letter, but an annual letter that said something far more radical, and I use that word advisedly, than it had ever been before. He came out and said that climate change was a critical risk factor and that BlackRock was going to see to it that companies and their boards fully understood the implications of this for their companies, that it was a responsibility for all companies to put this at the heart of what they were doing because, well, as we all know around this virtual table, our survival depends on it. So for me, when I joined the board of Eni in 2014, our corporate mission was we are an oil and gas company with, you know, a footprint in 33 countries, et cetera, et cetera. Now our corporate mission is we deliver clean, affordable, sustainable energy to all, and in particular to those who have no access to it. And our strategy is articulated around the SDGs. But most importantly, I would say, and this has been really reinforced by the pandemic, it's this sense that corporate purpose is not just the words on the mission statement. Corporate purpose is really what infuses the leadership and the staff with that sense of why they go to work every day. And it is so immensely impactful in motivating people. Our CEO runs a blog, which was revolutionary by the standards of this company, where ordinary rank and file, you know, write their Dear Claudio messages. Again, completely unheard of in the typically, traditionally very hierarchical Italian context. And the conversations, I've read them, include, Dear Claudio, I am so inspired by our pivot to becoming a clean energy company. I have always wanted my engineering skills to be put to the service of solving society's greatest problems. And I now feel like I have a good reason to go to work. I'm paraphrasing, but that essentially, I think, encapsulates why somebody would choose to work in an organization that is typically associated with, you know, despoiling the climate. And that is, you know, that is unfortunately true for many, many decades. And it's incumbent on any company that is, you know, large with very deep pockets, extraordinary capital and human capital resources, technology resources, to be part of the solution to climate change, but also to, you know, human rights abuses and so forth. So I think, you know, to me, what's really critical is the role that we as board leaders, our CEO, can play in conceptualizing their role as citizens beyond simply running a successful business, which is a must, or we will not be competitive, but actually reflecting on the role that we play in driving systemic change. Because at the end of the day, even if we hit all of our targets in terms of, you know, reaching net zero, that will not solve the problem unless everyone else does. And for everyone else to do that, we need to play a role that is one of setting an example, which sounds extremely presumptuous, but one of reaching out to stakeholders, including our supply chain, including working with our stakeholders, our suppliers and contractors, particularly those who face potential demise as oil and gas production shrinks and other types of energy production grow to take their place. What's going to happen to all of those smaller companies whose business depends on the traditional oil and gas? They have to change with us, and we work with them to help them on their transition journey. But also making sure, you've all heard, I'm sure, of the concept of stranded assets, assets that suddenly overnight lose their value. We're concerned, obviously, about not investing in assets that become stranded. We also don't want stranded people. We don't want our employees to have skills that are obsolete. We don't want our suppliers to have invested in equipment and people that are no longer demanded. We also need suppliers to support us in our new businesses. And so we see our role as really working with others to affect change, working with competitors to affect change, working with companies that are in our customers and just like-minded to drive change at a systemic level, to engage with government, to engage with civil society, to engage, of course, with the academic community, to see to it that we make the changes to our economic system on the scale and at the pace that is required. And when I say scale and pace, green hydrogen has to increase 100-fold if we're going to get where we need to go. That's the scale that we're talking about. Electric vehicles have to increase 20-fold. That's maybe more easily imaginable. It's still massive. So, you know, we're talking about, we are on the cusp of such a radical transformation, and we need to be prepared to run with it and to make sure that we don't get, you know, gobbled up in that disruption and disappear.
I'm glad you mentioned the pivotal role that the boards play in this whole transition. It's interesting to find out whether the expertise is really there on the board, because in order to be kind of making the right decision, you need to be properly informed. So the information needs to flow about the stakeholders, about their priorities. And I'm really glad to hear that there are the right intentions already there among the board members, and increasingly so. But is there the proper level of expertise, not only on the environmental issues, but also on the social relevant issues?
Now, the short answer is no. No, most boards simply do not possess these skills. Most board directors are recruited because of their expertise in finance, strategy, audit, change management sometimes, digital, right? These are all the hot topics. And most board directors are in their 60s and grew up professionally at a time when these skills were simply not necessary to reach the top of the corporate tree. So what you need are directors who know what they don't know. and open their ears and bring in perspectives that are not natural to them. The reason that we created the Climate Governance Initiative with the World Economic Forum was to plug that gap, because it became very clear to me that, you know, a fraction of 1% of directors, and this is corroborated by the headhunters who recruit them, a fraction of 1% of directors actually possess those skills. And so they need to pick them up very quickly. And so Chapter Zero is all about, or Chapter Zero, which is the brand name of the Climate Governance Initiative, is all about providing access to training modules and workshops and exchanges, live exchanges with policymakers, investors, academics, civil society activists who are sometimes hypercritical and distrustful of us in our role as business leaders, so that we can hear those outside perspectives and bring them into the boardroom. But it's not something that most directors naturally possess when they join boards. That needs to change.
Yeah. And with this kind of increased focus on non-financial reporting, sometimes it's very hard for the outside investor, even the knowledgeable, educated investor, to differentiate between faulty kind of responsibility claims and ones that are backed by real efforts. So any advice on that? Like, what would you look out for?
Yeah, well, you know, for a start, we have a European directive on shareholder rights and on transparency, actually two of them, which have been enacted in national legislation. We in Italy, for example, individually, personally face a fine of up to 50,000 euros if our non-financial report contains any inaccuracies or substantial omissions. So I can tell you that people pay close attention to the material that we then sign off on. Now, it's only disclosure, and disclosure is not a means, it's not an end in itself, it's a means, right? When you start to disclose what you're doing, you're confronted with the inadequacies in what you're doing. You're also challenged again and again by, in particular, investors for example, failing to set the appropriate targets. So when you disclose what your targets are and you say that you've met them, and investors turn around and say, that target is bogus, you know, it's down to your point about greenwashing. That really keeps you honest. So disclosure is an excellent catalyst to getting companies to change. Now, in the case of Eni, for example, I mean, I was able to watch that unfold over a 6-year period. We were always ticking every box and winning every award in terms of disclosure. But I knew that we were not, you know, that our core product was fundamentally problematic. It took us 6 years to get to the point where last February we were able to unveil a transformation strategy that was actually about changing completely the nature of the business over a period of...
And being challenged is a very positive development, because it's an education process for everybody involved. So it shouldn't be viewed as a threat. And
absolutely.
Asset stewardship efforts out there, you know, shouldn't be viewed as a threat, but this common effort to arrive at a better place than we have.
It's a resource. It's a resource. Exactly. I frankly consider, I mean, I always say to my colleagues on the board, let's map those investors and other critical voices, put them on a map for how pioneering they are. You might call them militant or, you know, extremist. I just call them pioneering. They're on a spectrum. And let's just say that where, you know, investor X is today, that's where BlackRock will be in 5 to 7 years, guaranteed. So they're early warning systems for me, as far as I'm concerned.
And the financial sector has a huge role to play in this whole transformation. So I'd like to talk to Leslie about his view on the role of the financial sector in catalyzing a more responsible corporate sector.
Thanks very much, Katya. And I think Karina has set the scene very well by saying that we are indeed, I believe, on the cusp of a significant transformation in the way that our system of accumulation or the way capitalism is viewed. You know, there has been many instances historically where a deep crisis normally can provide a burning platform for significant change. And as you know, in 1929, we had a crisis as deep as what we are going through today. And during that period, as Matthew Bishop will know, was one of the leading voices in impact investment. During that period, because accounting standards were very weak, they were not really centralized accounting standards at the time, and the whole profession of external auditors did not really exist. It only emerged after regulation in 1933. And that led to a fundamental sea change in the way that businesses operate. Many people believe that the current crisis that we're going through as a consequence of COVID provides such a historic moment again. Sir Ronald Cohen, who's one of the leading father figures of the impact investment movement, is saying that the time has now arrived to have what he calls impact-weighted accounting, where in addition to Shell reporting on its profitability or ExxonMobil reporting on its profitability, as fossil fuel companies, they should also be reporting on if they, you know, generated $5 billion of profits, also should be reporting that, you know, $2 billion of environmental degradation they have been responsible for. It is very likely that the depth of this current crisis could usher in such a major revolution where this idea of more socially responsible capitalism will become embedded in the mainstream. I say that because, as Karina also highlighted, there is a significant movement, firstly from investors, your large institutional investors, the BlackRocks of the world, the Amundis, all of these companies now have significant pools of capital devoted for sustainability causes. I'll just give you one specific example that is also happening in the financial services industry. I work for a bank called the New Development Bank, which is endowed with $50 billion of subscribed capital. This bank, and there's several other institutions of this kind today, have sustainability hard-coded in our very legal construct. In other words, it's not possible for us to finance a coal-fired power station. Let's take our energy portfolio, which is just over $3.5 billion today. It's in solar power, it's in hydro, it's in offshore wind. It is 100% green. The bank has issued its first capital markets activity when it issued a green bond here in China, was in a green format. So there are institutions being formed today whose DNA is already hard-coded towards this new movement. So I guess the note of optimism that I am sort of, or the what I'm trying to project here, Katya, is that it is likely that as deep as this crisis is, COVID has exposed the fragility of capitalism, the inequality. We've seen people protesting throughout the world, the issues around inclusion, large numbers of people not having a stake, women in particular being excluded to a great extent in many jurisdictions in the world, where women are unable to access the labor market, unable to access finance because they do not have access to legal title deeds, which they can use, let's say, land as collateral because they're unable to register assets in their name. So inclusion, focus on inequality, sustainability, and climate change will become central to the agenda of finance in the future.
Thank you for that, Leslie. And would be curious to hear whether this kind of wave of change is engulfing in a positive way, of course, the emerging markets, because often people kind of see US and Europe as leading this effort. But I, you know, NDB has been pioneering these exact concepts of social responsibility, social and environmental responsibility in the biggest emerging markets, and hopefully smaller emerging markets will follow.
Some of the largest, biggest emerging markets are members of our bank: Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. Let me just remind you that I think something like 70% of the most polluted cities in the world are in these countries that I've just mentioned. So we're starting off a very low base. The most polluted cities are in China, in India, and so on. But to give you a sense of the commitments that these countries have made, let's take China. China was one of the first of the biggest emerging markets to announce that it intends to be carbon neutral by 2050, or at least before 2060, to quote the actual announcement, in line with what Europe intends to do. China, for example, would discontinue fossil fuel traditional vehicles. It aims to have 40%, and I'll say that number again, 40 by 2035, electric vehicles, electric buses on the streets of every city here in China. I've been living in China for the last 5 years and have noticed just from living in Shanghai, the quality of air has changed in a very dramatic, literally just in the last 5 years, because people are more aware. Transparency is so important also in this movement. There's an app which you can download, and parents are very sensitive to that, because if the pollution goes above a certain level, then kids are not able to go to school. So just because of technology, these large emerging markets, the governments are propelled by the citizens towards change.
But also, isn't it true that, you know, it's the financial sector kind of catalyzes this change, expedites it, because environmental agenda is very important, and so is social agenda. And companies based in these countries, in order to attract capital, they have to transform themselves and the way they treat their communities, the way they treat their employees. So I hope that these efforts are underway in your jurisdictions, which you are working on.
Absolutely. I'll give you one more example. The financial system is being greened here in China in quite a significant manner, and these lessons have been transported in the other BRICS countries. I'll give you one example. We don't really carry much cash in China. You know, even the person on the street, the homeless person downstairs here from my hotel, has a QR code, because literally most people do not have cash anymore because of the mobile payment systems, right? So what these mobile e-commerce platforms are able to do now is to track and trace the extent of your purchases. So I flew from Shanghai to Beijing earlier this evening. If I took the train, it will give me a better sort of, because obviously there's more emissions coming from traveling by plane. If your purchases are all logged, obviously, and you can get a credit score, which eventually, once the system is fully operational, you'll be able to know exactly what is your footprint in terms of the purchases that you make. So the awareness around every single step that people take daily is going to become front and center of people's behavior. And this one last example, which I will make, is central banks is now introducing a system where they will give banks. So let's say Karina works for an oil company and I work for a green company. We are both, let's say, customers of ICBC Bank. The central bank will give a higher rate of interest with the capital that ICBC have in with them. If they have more customers like myself who are more green relative to the ones that have, let's say, a huge carbon footprint. So they will green what's called in technical terms the macroprudential framework. The central bank will give an incentive. You will earn higher rates of interest. So these things will, once it's introduced, will result in a sea change in the financial sector. So in short, what I would say is that there's a revolution underway. We are at the stage now where pretty soon, I would say in the next few years, we will see the result of what people like Matthew Bishop and others have been talking about for the last 15 years of creating a more socially responsible system of capitalism.
Thank you so much, Leslie. We have a little poll for the audience here, if the Global Leaders Program could kindly bring it up. So this is about your view as to the biggest forces behind this acceleration of corporate sustainability efforts. So if the audience could just cast their vote, that would be great, and we can reveal the results shortly. And while you're voting, I just would like to comment on something that Karina said about the importance of helping other companies kind of rise to the challenge. Not everybody has the same resources as some of the largest corporations. And I just want to kind of cite an impressive example that I've seen. Actually, it involved Karina and the webinars that she was hosting with HSBC, where HSBC could have, of course, held this information, valuable information, as very proprietary, but they revealed to the entire world, to everybody wanting willing to learn about how to run climate change scenarios and banks, you know, how to transform boards in order to accelerate the sustainability agenda. And it's in general, Chapter Zero offers, you know, a wealth of invaluable resources to anybody, really, anybody who is ready to learn. And to me, it's just, you know, just incredibly impressive that a bank would share something that traditionally would be viewed as a perhaps proprietary methodology that would set them apart from competition. But in this case, it's not about the competition because we're all in it together. So if the Global Leaders Program could kindly close the poll, and I'll reveal the results a little later. Now we would like to turn to, thank you, Leslie, by the way, and we would like to turn to Michael Zawi, who wears two hats. He is a prominent financier, as the bio just unveiled, but also involved in various nonprofit organizations, South Bank in particular. And I'd like to talk to him about how the corporate philanthropy efforts have evolved recently. You know, what's the value that businesses see in being involved in these efforts benefiting the community?
Thank you, Katya. Can you hear me fine?
Yes, thank you.
Disadvantage in speaking after our distinguished speakers is that a lot of the messages have already been made and much better than I ever would. But if you bear with me, I would like to step back and take our viewers through a rapid historical perspective on how we got to where we are. And I think both Karina and our next speaker, Leslie, expressed extremely well where we are today and what some of the pressures are. But I think it's important for us to just to get back and understand where we came from. And hopefully I'll give you a sense for where I think we're going. And the fundamental question you all understand, which underlies our discussion tonight, and I think this is what I want to make very clear to our non-business viewers today, is what is the purpose of a corporation in the world? It's a very simple question, but there's considerable debate about it, and even more so in today's world, where economic downturn, social unrest, globalization backlash, widening of inequalities, affirmative actions, and climate change are at the forefront of our daily news and preoccupation. And there can be no doubt that the pandemic has exacerbated the issues. I think one of the questions was, you know, is the movement accelerating? For sure it's accelerating. And that populist movements in the most developed countries have further fueled the debate. And so what of it? And how will it affect the ways in which business is conducted, and notably the attitude of business towards philanthropy in a broad sense? And the short answer is yes, it will affect it in a big way, and we already see it, as some of my previous speakers have indicated. For nearly half a century, the accepted purpose of a corporation, this is really important to remember, was, quote unquote, to maximize shareholders' value, end of quote. Karina knows a lot about this. That was the number one responsibility of boards in the US. Maybe not a model for the rest of the world. True, Europeans have been more inclined to use the word stakeholders rather than shareholders. Holland was a very good point in case for a long time. But the dominant model for sure was the US model, maximize shareholder value. And it all started with a now famous article by Milton Friedman, which Katya mentioned earlier. He was a legendary, for those of you who are not familiar, he was the founder of monetary theory of the School of Chicago. And in 1970, he wrote this piece in the New York Times Magazine. That's 50 years ago. And he dominated for the last 50 years, pretty much. And there he denounced squarely corporate social responsibility as a socialist doctrine. He goes on writing that the job of a corporation is, I'm quoting him, all of these are quotes, to make as much money as possible while conforming to the basic rules of the society, both those embodied in law and those embodied in ethical customs. Note the words, not beyond. You just need to, you know, confirm to the rule, to the basic rules, not even all the rules. Now, fast forward to 2017. Skip a few financial crises, oil tanker spills, Enron blow up, and so on and so forth. And in another seminal article published in the Harvard Business Review, Professors Bauer and Payne argue eloquently that it was all a big mistake. Corporations have, in fact, many functions. They provide goods and services, we know that. They provide employment. They invest in the future. They drive innovation, et cetera, et cetera. Their concern with corporate citizenship goes beyond legal compliance, which again had been Milton Friedman's mantra. They go as far, the two authors go as far as saying, writing that the Friedman model could be damaging to the broader economy. And they support their thesis not by using wishy-washy arguments about, you know, saving the planet, but by ruthlessly hugging trees, by ruthlessly dismantling that so-called agency model, which is what the world refers to for the Friedman discussion, using five legal and practical arguments. And one example, I'll give you just one example. There can be no systematic alignment between the interest of the corporation and that of its customers. In theory only, what's good for the company is good for the stock. In practice, it's not always the case. So what happened? Well, what happened, a lot happened. We had the Paris Accord on climate change. And let me go back to some of the things our speakers have already said. This had led or accompanied, I want to document what was said. This had led or accompanied an unprecedented boom in sustainable investment funds, which surpassed, are you ready, $1 trillion this summer for the first time on record. At my daughter, Karina is not gonna like that. At my daughter's graduation ceremony 2 years ago, in the big campus in the US, huge banners were displayed on campus urging the endowment, which is the largest in the world, you can guess, about 50 billion or so, to divest fossil fuels. The new European recovery package is $750 billion, mostly on green initiatives. Yes, as a result of the COVID crisis, but it's mostly focused on green initiatives. In 2019, Norges Bank sold out of 42 companies, mostly for using or producing coal. And in January, BlackRock's Larry Fink, mentioned again by Karina, $7 trillion under management, for those of you who are not in the financial world, okay? This guy runs a company which manages $7 trillion. So people listen when he talks. He wrote in an open letter to corporate CEOs, every government, company, and shareholder must confront climate change. And then he went beyond. He warned them, we will be, I'm quoting him, we will be increasingly disposed to vote against management and board directors when companies are not making sufficient progress on sustainability-related disclosures. They've been warned. That's very powerful. It didn't stop there. Under pressure from society and markets, I wouldn't know, Katya, how to answer your question. Is it the society first? Is this the market? Is this investors? I think it goes in that sense. I think markets respond and investors respond to society trends, not the other way around. I want to believe that. But corporations had to pay more attention to social issues. All over the world, boards are under pressure and increasingly under legal obligation to consider gender, ethnic, racial diversity in their composition. Let's take women for starters. Here, Europe leads the way. I don't know if everybody's familiar with that, but I thought it was an interesting set of statistics when I was doing my research for those remarks. Norway, France, Italy, Germany, Holland, and Belgium have established legal quotas. This is for on women board positions. On average, 40% of board seats must be held by women. In the US, gender diversity is largely driven by investors. BlackRock, again, encourages companies to have at least 2 women directors on the board. And California became in 2018 the first state to pass a law requiring that at least 1 woman on boards be on boards of public companies. More will follow suit, no doubt. But you can tell there's a bit of a lag in the US and certainly in the UK as well, where I'm calling from, versus some European continental countries, which have been a lot more aggressive in women representation. Beyond women, diversity is on everyone's mind. Big US fund Vanguard expects companies to publish their efforts to improve boardroom diversity, and they will ask questions. The consulting firm BCG, Boston Consulting Group, found that companies with above average diversity at the management level generate 19% higher innovation revenues than the others. Let's go one step beyond. The killing of George Floyd last May acted as a trigger for corporate action. In September, let me mention just a few. It's mind-boggling. I mean, I was blown away. In September, CT announced the $1 billion strategic initiative to help close the racial wealth gap. IBM and HP each announced expanded partnerships with historically Black colleges and universities. Bank of America issued a $2 billion Equality Progress Sustainability Bond. That's September. In October, Starbucks launched a new mentorship program tying executive compensation to team diversity in order to reach 30% of the workforce by 2025. American Express announced a $1 billion action plan to promote racial equity. JP Morgan pledged $30 billion over the next 5 years to solve the racial wealth gap, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The trend is clear. Corporations are taking actions and spending shareholders' money for a different purpose than the one they were doing before. So you might say, is this philanthropy? And I realize we need perhaps to bring us back to the core of our discussion. Or is this simply setting things straight, as in corporations to have a responsibility towards planet Earth and towards large chunks of humanity? So isn't that to be expected in the end? Aren't we simply playing catch up here? The point I'm trying to make is that there's been an acceleration in the realization by the corporate world of its duties beyond those to shareholders. And this perhaps, only perhaps, paved the way for better and more philanthropy in the future. Make no mistake, I do not expect similar pressure from investors or legislators for action in traditional philanthropic causes. Markets have quickly found a way, you will be amused by this, they've quickly found a way to justify what corporations are doing on the environment, social, and governance fronts. It's called ESG in our lingo. A recent study by Morgan Stanley Capital International shows that over a 4-year period, companies with ESG scores had a lower cost of capital. They had to find a way to explain why this is actually good for shareholders. Why is that? Because investors with a long-term investment horizon are increasingly adopting ESG, environment, social, and governance, as a risk management tool. UBS reports, quote, reducing portfolio exposure to social risks may be done by avoiding controversial industries, for example. And better corporate governance standard is known to reduce a firm's default risk, which directly impacts its cost of debt and therefore its cost of capital. So if ESG corporate actions can be seen as positive for business and for society, what can be said about traditional philanthropy? Katya, allow me another 2 minutes because I want to zero in on this. And I have a few observations. First, the role of tech. It's really critical. Massive wealth has been created by the market's enthusiasm for tech companies. In turn, founders have become very wealthy and become major donors. The most visible initiatives have been carried out personally. Also, perhaps, to avoid shareholders' criticism of misuse of corporate funds. The single biggest initiative is, of course, the Gates Foundation role in vaccines over the last 20 years, a very topical subject of interest indeed. It co-founded Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, in 1999 with a $750 million initial investment, which has surpassed $4 billion over time. They've helped vaccinate over 800 million children over the last 20 years. And of course, they're very active in the COVID crisis. Education is another area of acute interest to tech leaders. Gates Foundation, again, been involved in education reform for two decades. The Bezos Day One Fund has launched a network of full scholarship preschools in underserved communities. We can also mention the Chan Zuckerberg Education Initiative, now run by a former deputy secretary of the US Department of Education, and Jack Dorsey, the founder of Twitter and of Square, pledged $1 billion for girls' education. At the corporate level, no, let's go back to corporates. The numbers are big, but less impressive. Amazon, Facebook, Microsoft, Salesforce have pledged over $500 million towards boosting computer science education in the US. And of course, they have the ability to act as a very effective platform to channel donations, given their huge client, customers, whatever, members base, through, for example, Amazon Smile and Facebook fundraising. Switch back to, so covered education, let's talk about cultural activities now. Well, there the numbers drop fast. In the US, sponsorship spending on the arts totaled $1 billion in 2018. That's only about 5% of the total, while sports got a whopping 70% of sponsorship funding. Not quite the same exposure and not quite the same economics, of course, for the sponsors. In the UK, according to Arts Council, 15%, 1-5, of art funding comes from private sources. And that's a problem as public funding, which is 33%, is going down with budget cuts. And ticket sales, 52% of revenues, are halted at the moment. So you can imagine the situation we're all in. Besides, corporate sponsorship can be fraught with controversies. The British Museum in this country was criticized for receiving money from BP. There's always the question, do cultural institutions compromise artistically and ethically when they seek corporate funding? By accepting the money, the general public will have the impression that the institution, the cultural institution, endorses the corporate activities. Tate, for example, has refused funding from tobacco companies since 1986 as part of its code of ethics. And then, and I'll conclude, you have the Black Swan. You have the fire at Notre Dame de Paris. Within days, hundreds of millions have been pledged by French billionaires, I don't need to name them here, to reconstruct, to rebuild Notre Dame. Several French companies joined in, albeit at much, much lower levels. In total, over 900 million euros were pledged. And as a reference point, only a few tens of millions had been raised to build the Basilique Sacré-Cœur in Montmartre after the commune scare in the mid-19th century. So let me conclude. There's a clear trend. Corporate social responsibility is on the rise. The old model is dying, but priority remains with the ecology, social and governance issues. Tech moguls lack space, education, and extending their lives and ours if they manage to find the formula. Sports need no help, so I'm afraid the arts will continue to struggle for funding. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for making it particularly clear that perhaps now is the time when the old barriers for companies to be more involved in social and environmental issues, the old barriers that simply lied in the fact that the model, the business model was preconditioned on making money only. Yeah. And now company purpose becomes more central to activities, and that's becoming mainstream, and that's upheld by the investment community. So hopefully, we will move into a different era when social efforts and nonprofit organizations don't have to struggle as much, and in particularly the art sector that our audiences represent. So I would like to actually reveal the results of the poll, if we may, that was. launched a few minutes earlier, and that was about the drivers of today's sustainability. And as we can see, the majority of people see that there is acceleration going on, and they view the biggest driving force as the society itself, followed by governments and investors, and some companies, of course, take it as an internally driven initiative. And that's great. Thank you so much. So I would like to remind again the audience about the possibility of asking questions that we can address at the end of this panel. And with that, I would like to talk to Matthew, the author of the book, a great book that everybody should take a look at, Philanthrocapitalism, and it's available in Spanish. And Matthew is also a co-founder of the Social Progress Index. Matthew, can you talk to us about the innovative capitalism models that you discussed in your book quite a while ago? So you were at the forefront of this thinking before it became mainstream. Some of the perhaps practical examples of how philanthrocapitalism manifests itself.
Yeah, well, great to be with you all today. And this is a great discussion so far. And Michael, I echo your comments that it's hard to follow such great speakers because you've all said a lot of what I was going to say. So in a nutshell, the gist of the book was, and a lot of my work since was, that you know we're only going to solve the big social problems if the wealth creators and companies play a part alongside government and civil society in finding solutions. And that prior to COVID, I had seen growing trends, as we've heard already, for companies to and investors to take that more seriously, especially around climate, but also obviously through this sort of big growth in individual philanthropy by the super rich. We've seen this growing focus on trying to solve some of these intractable problems, as well as solve problems that we hadn't thought were intractable, like living on Mars that Michael alluded to and things of that kind. But I want to just briefly think about where we are now in terms of COVID and how that is changing these things and might change things going forward, because obviously the arts community has been devastated more than almost as much as the tourism sector for very similar reasons, because of the lockdowns and the natural desire to avoid crowds. You all are probably thinking, well, as we come out of COVID, hopefully over the next 6 months to a year, how is the business world and how are philanthropies going to help us recover? And how do we make sure that whatever help they are willing to give comes to us? What should we be talking about? And I think there are two facts that I would just draw attention to. And they're very much in my spirit of a philosophy that I came to own while I was at The Economist, which is called paranoid optimism. I am a paranoid optimist. I believe in human ingenuity can deliver enormous progress, but I spend all my time worrying about what could go wrong. And so I'm both delighted that we've finally nailed down the lid on Milton Friedman's coffin and that we no longer believe in his view of the world. I also, though, think we're going to enter into a period called peak corporate bullshit or peak greenwashing or inclusion washing or whatever else you want to call it. And so, figuring out who's sincere and who is not in this next few years is going to be very key. And a lot of people who will claim to be on the side of accountability and sustainability will actually be within the parameters that exist, will be fighting for as little change as possible whilst claiming to do the opposite. So there's going to be a strange environment on that hand. So the rhetorical battle about the purpose of companies has been won. The real battle is all to be played for, I think, in terms of what corporates are really up to and whether they're really friendly. And that may be both an opportunity and a risk for the arts. I mean, it may seem that supporting artistic endeavors that talk a lot about the issues but don't really necessarily deliver immediate threat to companies' own interests may be an easier bet than, I don't know, funding efforts on anti-corruption in the mining industry or something of that kind, which are obviously much more pressing, going to be more important going forward as we move into the renewable economy, where all these scarce metals in corrupt regimes are even more important to the new technologies that we're going to be using. The other clear change is that due to COVID, progress, social progress has gone backwards significantly. The Social Progress Index has a good measure of our progress towards the UN Sustainable Development Goals. They're supposed to be achieved by 2030. Prior to COVID, we were estimating that on current trends, they would be achieved around 2072. And we're now forecasting 2094, which is obviously a long way too late. And so there is this general situation that we're going into, which is, the social progress is going backwards. Corporates have discovered the rhetoric of sustainability and inclusion. And the third factor is, while social progress has gone backwards, corporates and wealthy individuals that invest in them have seen an acceleration in all the innovations that have been called the fourth industrial revolution, which means that they've got much richer faster. And so capital's share of GDP has gone up a lot. And so the question is whether we can also see those people and companies that have got richer and whose stated values have changed in a more sympathetic way, will they actually act in a way that addresses the growing inequality and the growing failure to achieve the SDGs? And, I think we need to demand it of them, and we need to really a role, and the arts can play a big role in calling them to action, I think. In terms of art as an expressive voice of the needs of the majority of society to those who are powerful and to get them to focus on the right issues. I also do think that, there is this moment coming out of COVID where because the arts were so badly hurt, an argument to philanthropy and to businesses that reinvest in your community and what makes the communities around where you operate great, that simple appeal ought to be taken very seriously. But obviously, the more any pitch to these people and companies can be presented in terms of either sustainability or inclusion, the more you can demonstrate diversity and also broader inclusion of the community in your artwork. So all those programs that have been going on for years, probably a bit less core to your art institution's activities than maybe they need to be going forward. They need to really be your selling point, purpose and mission, rather than performances is going to be and paintings is going to be the language that people will respond to, I think, in this next period.
And Matthew, as a follow-up question, who would you find for yourself to be one of the inspiring philanthrocapitalists? And here, I'm particularly interested in a company, not an individual. The individuals are the suspected ones, but any company that you've seen where you were particularly impressed, which integrated purpose into its mainstream activities?
Well, I think you would look at... historically, I would say, you'd look at the role of something like Starbucks, where they have, had campaigns for veterans. They've been very outspoken in terms of giving their baristas access to university education and being supportive in that respect. I think one of the big questions, big companies we should be watching very carefully in this respect will be Amazon, which has made this announcement that it's going to reinvest its profits in its frontline workers, making sure that they are much better and safer. Is that complete bullshit or is that actually a real thing? So there's, I think there are very interesting companies that probably won't be so well known globally, but in the US, There's a spectacles company called Warby Parker that has a business that is a business alliance with a company that a non-profit that does work in terms of cataracts and sight in the global south and developing world. And so every pair of glasses you buy, money goes towards improving the sight of people that don't have access to that kind of product that we take for granted. So there are some great examples out there. Unilever is probably a very well-known company in terms of its sustainable living plan, that it's really working hard with the people who in its supply chain, the small farmers, to make sure that they can have a sustainable lifestyle. And then in terms of branding, I mean, there's companies like Nike, which have obviously used, as Michael alluded to, very quick to spot the opportunity around the George Floyd moment to really sort of assert their credentials, having worked, being very cause-driven in their marketing over the years. And obviously this is a period where other companies are also being called out for making pro-diversity, pro-Black Lives Matter statements that people felt were quite different from what their actual behavior had been. And so I think that's a sort of that period with the Black Lives Matter movement and how corporates responded is going to be a sort of maybe a template for how things go forward in terms, or should go forward, where a lot of people will be saying things and then it's civil society and the media need to come in and actually weigh up what's real and what's marketing.
So, and then a quick follow-up question on something that we actually discussed in our panel 10 years ago, and it was a fascinating one about the metrics, the success metrics. And I would like to then ask the same question to Jane. So be ready. So it's about metrics that for measuring success in social investment. Everybody talks about the ROI, but sometimes it's quite intangible when it comes to the impact of these programs. Sometimes you can quantify impact, sometimes you cannot. But in order to receive the funding and support from companies, they all are looking for some sort of an ROI. And we touched upon this in our panel, the World Economic Forum Young Global Leaders panel, on how to kind of push this forward, create some of the metrics for success that could be acceptable to organizations.
Yeah, I mean, I think, as I said then, the evolution of data, big data and so forth, and the evolution of accountability demands all mean that we're all going to be measured more. There's no way around that. And that's the future, more and more data, more and more measurement. And I think the real challenge is to make sure the right things are being measured and you're being held account to the right data. And, I do think the arts is an area where that is particularly difficult, but I don't think impossible. And I do think if you can find the right metrics, that increases your chances of getting business or big philanthropists to put money your way. And I think a lot of the data that people are going to be quite interested in is showing your ability to show engagement, the ability to build communities, broader communities, and to sort of generate conversation and narratives around your work that spread to a broader group, because I think all these donors and companies are very interested in those sorts of questions. And how do we counter the Facebook filter bubble kind of type of engagement that's been so destructive with something that's more grounded and strengthening of communities? And so all that stuff, I think, is in arts organizations, core essence of what they are, but they need to do a better job of telling that story for the purposes of corporates and donors.
Thank you, Matthew. Thank you. And so with the same question, I'd like to turn to Jane and also and Julia. We would like to hear your views on some of the ways that the arts institutions can secure more long-term partnerships, some of the lessons and perhaps some of the takeaways that you've just heard that can be used by the arts institutions. And of course, Jane can talk from the North American perspective and Julia from the European perspective to paint the complete picture.
Sure, thank you, Katya. I'll just say Matthew referred to himself as a paranoid optimist. I guess as a Canadian, I'm a polite enthusiast, and I think that right now it's a great opportunity for the arts. And as Michael noted, it's the same story in Canada in terms of the support for the arts from the corporate sector. Support philanthropically is only about 5%. So clearly we have to do a better job at storytelling. But on the flip side, the enthusiastic, optimistic side, that means we have nowhere to go but up. So just before I answer the question, a little bit of background on the National Arts Center. We are Canada's home for the performing arts, bilingual, multidisciplinary. We're located on the unceded, unsurrendered territory of the Algonquin and Anishinaabe nation. We produce, we create, we tour art in classical music, theater, English theater, French theater, Indigenous theater, popular music variety, and we nurture the generation of audiences and artists from across Canada. My role at the foundation is to work with a terrific team to find partners from both the corporate sector and of course philanthropists to underline and support the National Arts Center's mission and mandate. And over the last decade or so, we've raised about $150 million towards that end. Most of the support we receive is actually not from the corporate sector. It does come primarily over 80% from the non-corporate sector. However, we do look to our partners in the corporate sector really as partnerships versus transactional, so not check writers. We look for ways to deepen the relationship between ourselves and our corporate partners. Just to say that people have mentioned that the impact of the pandemic on the performing arts sector, we have seen devastation in terms of the livelihood of artists across the country, around the world. I'm going to be sitting in a concert hall on Saturday evening hearing one of the world's greatest violinists, Canadian James Ennis, with our wonderful National Arts Center Orchestra, with only 50 people in the audience because we are not allowed by public authorities to have more than 50 people. So that is not a sustainable business model. But on the upside, we have to remember that our case for support that we're making in front of corporations. And as I said, we have room to improve in terms of that storytelling because we're only getting about 5% of the philanthropy. But we are right now in a stuck in an elevator moment. One of my friends refers to this with our partners, with our donors. And this is the time that we can engage with our corporate partners about our mission and relevance and explore the ways that we can sustain those relationships. Corporations, as someone mentioned earlier on, that this is not new. Corporate giving has happened, it's been going on for years. Most Fortune 500 companies have CSR programs. And in fact, in Canada, corporate giving was about $4 billion last year. But what businesses are going to be looking for as a result of the pandemic and the social unrest that we have seen over the last year is that purpose solutions. And that's where the arts really can address that. We're all about purpose and finding that. And the intersection between the two about what business needs to do from the pressures that Karina was talking about and others from investors and societal pressures, as we saw in the polling, this is where we can step in and provide the kind of intersection between what the arts can deliver and what business is looking for. And so just a small example about a partnership that we struck with RBC, which is one of Canada's largest financial, it is Canada's largest financial institutions. When we realized early on the pandemic that Canadian artists were losing their livelihood, my brilliant programming colleagues at the National Arts Center came up with an idea to pay artists to perform out of their living rooms. And so it was called Canada Performs. And so they came to us and said, look, we want to pay $1,000 to as many artists as we can just to get them that rent money for the first couple of months. And so we went to RBC and Facebook as the streaming partner, and we were able to pay more than 800 artists to play in their living rooms and basements to get the message out about that live music is coming back, that we're still there, that we are part of the the much needed part of the recovery. And so a partnership like that, where we'd be going back to your question, Katya, about ROI, we were able to demonstrate, we knew with the Facebook pushing it out as a platform, we could get high viewership. We had close to 5 million views of those 800 artists, some artists who were emerging artists who really would do a show at at our theater and our, 200 seat theater, we're getting 40,000 views of their shows. And so the ROI that we were able to demonstrate with that, to say, we know we will get the viewership, we will get the eyeballs, we'll have a great story to tell. So that helped us package the proposal to, as I say, approach a corporate partner. And so, you know, it worked out fantastically for the artists. And I think that's what we all need, is that kind of partnership. So I'll stop there and I'll let Julia jump in.
Thank you so much.
I felt that was very, very inspiring what you just said. And I completely agree with you on many, many points, especially also we are in an elevator basically at the moment. And the only way we can go is up. I have to say that I am, although the situation at the moment is very, very difficult, I am a very inspired optimist at the moment, because many of you might not know, but the festival celebrated its centenary this summer, this August. And when we heard about, okay, it's Corona crisis and basically all other institutions could not play, we said, okay, we need to develop something, how we can play, because we owe it to our founders. We were founded in 1920. We all know how Europe looked after World War I. And the founders of the festival said, and they were basically convinced that the arts could reconcile people and even peoples whom war had driven against each other. And they said, art needs to be more as a more than a decoration. It needs to be the meaning and the food of life. And then if you go on within the history of the festival, in 1945, after the World War II, General Mark Clark, who was the commander of the occupying forces in Salzburg, he chose for the first appearance, the first public appearance in occupied Austria, the Salzburg Festival in August 1945. And he said that the early reintroduction of a festival would be proof that an independent Austria could soon be rebuilt. So coming from that background, we know it was important to tell our story, and we managed, and I can tell you this, I've never been in performances that were so inspiring, that were so felt in your, you could feel them in your heart and in your soul, and it really proved that art does something to each individual. When it comes to the financial side, Jane, we are a bit probably unique also from the for Europe, because we also have to fund 75% of our budget privately. Normally in Europe, that is exactly the contrary. So for us, it's basically been already a long, long, long run to getting private investors and company donors. I feel that we do not need to reinvent ourselves, but we need to be much clearer when it comes to messaging, when it comes to what our vision is, what arts can do to society. And we also, I feel, we need to be much more inclusive on what the company's goals would be. I know sometimes, and we've also been criticized about partnerships, as you might know, we had a long-term partnership with Nestlé, and we had so many calls always when there was, again, a water issue with Nestlé. Why are you partnering with them? You should be independent. You're a cultural institution. You should not sell yourself. And then when it came to tobacco, we also agreed we would not take tobacco companies. We would not take companies that are in the, let's call it, war sector, who produce weapons or things like that. But I feel we can give the companies much, but also the companies can give us much. And let me give you an example. So for some years ago, we had, it was a partnership that was running for 14 years, something like that. And they had a problem. They wanted to get new, creative, and a bit diversified employees. And we started the discussion on, could we do a cooperation on contemporary music? And then we said, why don't we try to add to that a program for them to find employees? So we figured out we could create something on creativity and maybe arts and science. And through that, they really had the exposure to a different recruitment process, to different people. And it, they said it really, really helped them. So I feel we should talk much better. Like we have an expertise in creativity. We have an expertise in the performance field. And when we open up to our partners, or if we would be able to open up to our partners more to include them in the so-called artists' families and in the creative families, we could really develop fruitful partnerships that would then also influence society on a long-term basis. And thus we could really get the cultural ROI.
Thank you. Thank you, Julia, for your comments. We unfortunately have only 2 minutes left, so I would like to turn to Leslie and Matthew. We have a number of fantastic questions here, and I would like to just synthesize and hopefully you could give us like a 30-second answer to each. So our audience is wondering, how do you get smaller countries involved in this transformative effort? And that's for Leslie. And for Matthew, how do you get smaller companies involved? So countries and companies involved in this social responsibility initiatives. So Leslie.
I think most of us agree tonight that there is a movement underway, right? That there's often companies that play a catalytic role, whether it be multinationals that have more far-sighted leadership, that have people with looking at their long-term self-interest, who engineer changes. And Matthew and others, Michael, have already made reference to some of those companies. BlackRock, Larry Fink, for example, comes to mind. But this is a global movement. It is not about large versus small. I think there's an unstoppable momentum, and it will, you know, it's like, you know, the sort of tide rising and all boats will eventually rise. I think that whether it's small or large, everybody will be embraced by this movement.
Thank you. Matthew,
Say again, Katia.
Go ahead, about the small companies.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's so much about small versus big, but I do think that the challenge every company is wrestling with is in this changed world that we're going into, you know, you need leadership change, you need internal culture change. And I think many of the skills that you'll need to succeed in this more complex, diverse, socially engaged world are skills that are natural to arts organizations. And I think there may be opportunities to invite in, you know, companies in your community, smaller companies and bigger companies, and say, look, come and spend a few hours with us. We'll do some, you know, performance workshops and you know, diversity conversations, and maybe if you're doing work that is relevant to helping people think through their role in society, you know, you could host those companies and form relationships with them in your community. And so I think this is both at that narrow level of how you interact with the companies around you, but also the role that arts can play in helping to frame a narrative around real corporate citizenship and responsibility, as opposed to the window dressing variety. I think this is a moment of great opportunity for the arts. And I thought Julia and Jane's comments, you know, really point the way forward for everybody, I think.
Thank you, Matthew. And clearly there is still a lot of work ahead of us, but this great tectonic shift is already underway. And I think now it's about a time that we make concrete steps in this direction and not wait for anybody to pave the way. So thank you, everybody, for appearing today on this diverse panel. And I'll hand it over to Gosia to wrap up.
Thank you so much, Katia. And thank you to all of you who have joined the conversation today. On behalf of the organizations involved in this, the Global Leaders Program, the Spanish Association of Symphony Orchestras, Classical Next, Banco de la República, Fundación BBVA, and Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda, We invite you now to stay with us for a special follow-up panel discussion focused on adapting this theme we just discussed to the context of art sectors in the Iberoamericas. This session entitled Enfoque Colombia features a very distinguished panel of guests that include Fernando Cortes, president of Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda, José Francisco Aguirre, CEO of Fundación Mario Santo Domingo, and Juan Alonso Mendoza, artistic director of Spain's Escuela Reina Sofía, and will be moderated by Natalie Oso of Spanish League of Orchestras. This session will begin in 15 minutes following a short pause. In the meantime, I would also like to take this opportunity to invite you to our upcoming session, which will happen at the same time in just 1 week on December 10. And as political, cultural, and societal conflicts run rampant around the world, those operating at the front lines take part in our panel discussion entitled Discord and Dissonance, Harmony in Unlike Places, that will address the use, the efficacy, and the impact of using the arts to bridge divides. And now we conclude by saying thank you to our today's exceptional expert panel, Karina Litvak, Chapter Zero and NISBA, Matthew Bishop, the Social Progress Index and formerly The Economist, Leslie Masdorf, New Development Bank, Julia Miller, Salzburg Festival, Jane Watson, National Arts Center Foundation Canada, Michael Zawi, Southbrook Center, and ex Morgan Stanley. On behalf of the all public tuning in, we really appreciate you sharing your perspectives with us today. And of course, huge thanks to Katia for your vision and leadership in moderating this fruitful session. Our thanks to all of you who have joined from around the world to listen. Have a good afternoon, good evening, or good rest of the day. Stay safe and healthy. And now we will go into a brief pause before returning with the Enfoque Colombia debrief session in Spanish in just 15 minutes. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Global Leaders Program has catalyzed social revolutions in various parts of the hemisphere by inspiring young people to start Music for Change programs or to be a part of Music for Change programs in their respective homes. Through the scores of young people who participate in the Global Leaders Program and are exposed to the opportunities that exist for this kind of work in countries or in our hemisphere, the Global Leaders Program is transforming lives in many countries around the hemisphere.
Pretty much gymnastics for the brain. You utilize every area of your brain and you spend a lot of time dealing with your own emotions as well as learning how to work with each other, with other people in teams. And so it's natural that you then grow into almost like a family and want to help the other person because you know if they make a mistake, you're also making a mistake as well. Because of all of these elements, it just makes you into a better person in general. And so I believe if we have more music programs and more musicians around the world, violence would be a thing of the past very quickly.
Mosaicos surge en el seno de la Asociación de Orquestas por una necesidad que teníamos de no solo de hacer algo conjunto que nos diera algo de visibilidad, sino de mostrar todo ese trabajo que hacemos, de todo nuestro compromiso que tenemos con la sociedad y demostrar de qué manera estamos intentando devolver a la sociedad una parte de lo que la sociedad nos da.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Pero yo creo que tienen que ser curtes, porque son corchés, ¿no? Eso sí.
Bueno, el proyecto Mosaico de Sonidos para nosotros ha significado pues un sueño hecho realidad, porque siempre estamos deseando encontrarnos en espacios compartidos donde las personas son personas, tienen sus capacidades y las ponen encima de la mesa, ¿no? Con discapacidad intelectual, pues les ponemos una etiqueta de que no son suficientemente capaces o no tienen habilidades o talentos para llegar al nivel. Y cuando tú lo que haces es crear un entorno, pues un entorno amigo, donde acoges a todo el mundo, pues vas viendo que lo inclusivo significa que cada uno pone lo que tiene. Y cuando tú encuentras al otro y el otro te da lo que tiene, generalmente te sorprendes. Y te sorprendes que hay una capacidad, un talento, una sensibilidad, una visión distinta de las cosas que a ti te enseña.
Eres un artista.
This is a call to arms, a fight for something we all love. We need to broaden and open the discussion amongst us, and we need to do it now.
This is not a conference once a year. This is a movement.
Of course, this is an era of fast communication, but just being able to sit together with somebody and have a conversation face to face, I think that human connection is something that is extremely valuable.
There's nothing like being together, being able to listen to each other. That's where some of our greatest ideas get sparked.
About new ways to experience classical music, new projects, new artists, new repertoire, and all sorts of exciting, innovative ways of looking at classical music.
Classical Nix as a nexus hub where everyone from all over the world who's doing something relevant to classical music come together in one point and then get together and to reignite that passion and to refuel again.
Well, I think it's the only place really internationally where you can find all sectors of the classical music industry represented.
I think the more globally connected we become, the better
music will make.
El desarrollo de talento en el arte es un pilar fundamental para el progreso hacia una sociedad más justa, equitativa e innovadora. La Filarmónica Joven de Colombia nace del sueño de la Fundación Bolívar da Vivienda, con el propósito de inspirar la construcción de proyectos de vida artísticos para el fortalecimiento del tejido social y cultural del país. Cada año la orquesta convoca a un selecto grupo conformado por grandes intérpretes de todas las regiones del país, que representan calidad humana, artística y excelencia musical, y los acompaña para que sigan siendo líderes inspiradores de cambio, al compartir con niños y niñas de escuelas del país conocimientos y buenas prácticas musicales aprendidas en la orquesta a través de espacios de formación con grandes maestros, giras nacionales e internacionales, y experiencias al lado de los mejores directores y solistas del mundo. Durante estos 10 años, la joven, como es conocida por sus seguidores, se ha convertido en una fuerza arrolladora que ha inspirado a más de 450 mil jóvenes músicos. Que Colombia se enamore de la música sinfónica y que el mundo se enamore de Colombia ha sido la apuesta de la orquesta en cada uno de sus ensayos, conciertos, talleres y encuentros artísticos en los que su música se ha convertido en un referente que ha despertado el orgullo de todo un país.
El nivel de profesionalismo que ya tienen, la dedicación, la seriedad, el estudio, el ímpetu, desde el primer concierto llegaron muy preparados.
Son unos muchachos muy talentosos que lo dan todo en el escenario y eso es lo más importante.
La Filarmónica Joven de Colombia ha presentado 37 residencias artísticas, 13 giras nacionales en 26 ciudades del país. Seis giras internacionales en 29 ciudades. En los últimos años, la orquesta ha trabajado por ser un símbolo prominente de la cultura musical nacional en el exterior, haciendo vibrar al público y la crítica con una propuesta innovadora en la música sinfónica que ha deleitado a más de 160 mil espectadores, interpretando los más ambiciosos repertorios y compartiendo su pasión con reconocidos músicos internacionales. La joven ha potenciado el desarrollo profesional de más de 600 jóvenes músicos, quienes son seleccionados a través de un riguroso proceso de admisión, que solo tiene en cuenta el talento, la disciplina y la pasión en cada interpretación. A este gran esfuerzo se han sumado 28 de los más importantes directores a nivel mundial, 22 solistas del mayor reconocimiento y 167 talleristas que han entregado su experiencia y conocimiento para forjar prometedoras carreras artísticas.
Y sin ninguna duda, esta es una de las orquestas juveniles más talentosas que he conocido.
La Filarmónica Joven de Colombia es hoy una de las mejores orquestas jóvenes de Sudamérica. Organizaciones del más alto nivel en el mundo han reconocido su importancia para el desarrollo musical latinoamericano. La orquesta ha sido reconocida por la crítica, los medios de comunicación, músicos de talla internacional, importantes personalidades y el público más exigente del mundo.
Es una orquesta que es de todos. Es la orquesta que representa la juventud y que representa, por su nombre, por su concepto, a Colombia.
Cada músico de la Filarmónica Joven de Colombia representa entusiasmo, creatividad, alegría, valores que generan orgullo. Ellos son una evidencia del arduo trabajo de familias, escuelas, universidades y organizaciones sociales que luchan por el desarrollo musical y social del país.
Bueno, bienvenidos nuevamente al panel Inversión Privada para el Bien Común, repensando la filantropía y el impacto social. Y vamos a reestudiar esta sesión que acabamos de ver con Enfoque Colombia. Enfoque Colombia se realiza gracias a la alianza de The Global Leaders Program, la Asociación Española de Orquestas Sinfónicas AEOS, Classical Next, el Banco de la República de Colombia, la Fundación BBVA y la Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda. Hoy contamos con tres invitados que resumen de alguna manera lo que acabamos de ver en la sesión internacional dentro del contexto colombiano por su experiencia, por su trabajo a nivel social, empresarial y artístico. Contamos hoy con Juan Alonso Mendoza, que lleva 20 años como director artístico de la Fundación Albeniz y sus principales programas, la Escuela Superior de Música Reina Sofía y el Instituto Internacional de Música de Cámara de Madrid, siendo también director de producción del Encuentro de Música y Academia de Santander y del Concurso Internacional de Piano de Santander, Palomo Xi. También tenemos con nosotros a Fernando Cortés del Grupo Bolívar. Fernando es vicepresidente de Responsabilidad Social Corporativa del Grupo Bolívar, director ejecutivo de la Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda, miembro de varios consejos directivos de organizaciones sociales como Empresarios por la Educación, Colombia Líder, Compartamos con Colombia, Fundación Nacional Batuta, Sinfónica Nacional, Connect Bogotá, Así Vamos en Salud, SECODES, entre otros, en donde desarrolla una valiosa gestión que ha permitido la generación de impactos sociales transformacionales en Colombia. Y también nos acompaña José Francisco Aguirre de la Fundación Santo Domingo. José Francisco es director ejecutivo y ha sido director ejecutivo también de Compartamos Colombia. Fue gerente del proyecto de estructuración del primer fondo de inversión de impacto en Colombia. Participó activamente en la consolidación de la red de ángeles inversionistas de Bavaria. Es cofundador y promotor del Festival Detonante, miembro de la Junta Directiva de Profamilia, Carnaval de Barranquilla y Pro Barranquilla, y ha sido conferencista sobre sostenibilidad, emprendimiento, fortalecimiento institucional e innovación de impacto. Entonces les doy la bienvenida a los tres. Muchas gracias de nuevo por aceptar esta invitación. Espero que hayan podido escuchar parte o todo el webinar que acabamos de hacer. Les hago una introducción muy, muy rápida y muy concisa sobre lo que hemos estado discutiendo durante esta hora y media. Y vamos a cerrarlo con la primera pregunta de cuál es el propósito de una empresa en el mundo de hoy. La charla anterior comenzaba con una reflexión sobre el modelo de las empresas en los últimos 50 años. Y hablábamos de Friedman, que afirmaba que la única obligación de las empresas era generar capital o generar un valor agregado para los stakeholders de las empresas. Y también veíamos cómo esta afirmación había hecho que nos condujéramos a una destrucción del planeta a nivel ambiental y también a un aumento de la desigualdad, porque se entró en una mentalidad de acumulación de capital sin límite. Sin embargo, el desarrollo de las empresas mostró que empezaban a invertir en la sociedad, en los avances, en el desarrollo tecnológico, en implicarse en el desarrollo también de políticas y de políticas sociales. Entonces, la labor de la empresa fue mucho más allá de la acumulación de capital. En este momento, y sobre todo con la aceleración que ha ocurrido a través de la crisis, de la pandemia que estamos viviendo y del cambio climático, más las revoluciones sociales, más el abogo por la diversidad, por los derechos de las mujeres, por cerrar las brechas sociales, todo lo que está ocurriendo, se pide todavía más a las empresas que desarrollen una labor mucho más allá que la generación de capital. Entonces, para abrir este foro muy rápidamente, voy a hacer la misma pregunta para que puedan responderla los tres en 5 minutos, les pido por favor, y es, ¿creen que existe una mayor conciencia y redireccionamiento de las empresas hacia la responsabilidad social? ¿Cómo experimenta cada uno esto desde su institución? Entonces, si les parece bien, empezamos con Fernando, Juan y José Francisco. Fernando, te paso la palabra.
Gracias, Natalie. Primero que todo, pues muchas gracias a todos por la invitación y la participación en esto, en este foro que me pareció muy interesante también escuchar a todos los panelistas anteriores. Yo primero que todo, yo no creo que el mundo esté más desigual. Yo creo que, y en eso podemos revisar cifras. Adicionalmente, hoy en día tenemos la posibilidad, creo que la mayoría de los seres humanos, muy pocos, o digamos que relativamente pocos, ¿no? Sí sigue habiendo muchísima gente en situación de pobreza, pero eso se ha reducido de una manera extraordinaria. Y hoy en día tenemos acceso a toda la información en un celular. Eso hace 20 años no era posible. Eso hace 20 años o 30 años tendríamos que el que tuviera una enciclopedia o tuviera acceso a una biblioteca, pues lo podría hacer. De resto, no. Entonces, yo creo que el pastel se ha agrandado. Hay unos que tienen más. Siempre van a haber unos que tienen más. Pero la gran mayoría de nosotros también tenemos más. Y tenemos muchísimo más de los que tuvieron nuestros antepasados, 2 o 3 generaciones. Así es que yo creo que en ese sentido uno también tiene que ser un poco llevar las cosas de llevar una perspectiva real de las cosas. Yo creo que el capitalismo ha sido una fuente inagotable de desarrollo y progreso. Milton Friedman decía que las empresas solamente estaban dedicadas a rendirle beneficios a sus accionistas y sus accionistas podrían hacer con sus recursos lo que quisieran. Yo creo que eso pues ha sido como un discurso que ha pasado como de moda, porque realmente hoy en día las empresas, o no hoy en día, siempre las empresas han procurado generar un bienestar social, porque cualquier producto que se venda pues hay alguien que le va a beneficiar el producto o el servicio y eso va a generar ese apoyo. La competencia también generó un mayor apoyo y un mayor desarrollo en mejorar los servicios, en mejorar los productos para beneficiar a los clientes, y los clientes cada día se volvieron más exigentes. Hoy en día tenemos muchísimos clientes, muchísimos también beneficiarios en donde están buscando encontrar pues más, como diríamos, más por menos, mayores beneficios. Hoy en día nadie compra un celular para que solamente uno pueda marcar por teléfono. Pasé una llamada telefónica. Hoy en día el celular ya es como parte, la extensión del cuerpo de uno y de la mente de uno. Y en ese sentido, pues, ha evolucionado, el mundo ha evolucionado en eso. El consumidor se ha vuelto más exigente. Yo creo que gracias a ese desarrollo social, el desarrollo educativo, la gente pues está siendo mucho más consciente. Uno ve en lugares apartados personas teniendo conversaciones por chat con otras personas de otros municipios y uno se da cuenta que ese desarrollo pues es gracias al capitalismo, pero el capitalismo ha venido también cambiando. El capitalismo ha venido cambiando y se ha vuelto más social. Están temas de los ODS, después de los antes de los objetivos del milenio, ahora los ODS. Y el mundo entero yo creo que está enfocado en irse no a la destrucción del planeta, porque el planeta creo que no lo vamos a destruir, sino que la humanidad se va a acabar. Pero en ese sentido también la humanidad ha sido muy resiliente y ha logrado encontrar fórmulas para resolver los problemas. Y hoy en día pues vemos muchísimas actividades en mejoras del medio ambiente, en mejoras de utilización de las energías renovables. En ese sentido yo creo que estamos, de cierta manera, hay un progreso que no para. Ahora, obviamente pues hay descontentos en todas partes, pues qué bueno que hayan descontentos, porque pues no podemos estar todos diciendo qué felicidad que estamos así de bien o así de mal, pero queremos estar mejor. Y yo creo que vamos por muy buen camino. Nos encantaría ir más rápido. Estamos también entrando a una época de la velocidad de las cosas y que todo lo quiero para allá y todo funciona allá. Pero si uno se pone a mirarse solamente nuestro país hace 30 años era otro país. Hoy Colombia es un país absolutamente distinto. Tenemos una cantidad de oportunidades. Tenemos solamente en el tema musical. Hoy en día hay más de 45 de facultades de música. Hace 30 años, de golpe no las contábamos con una mano. Entonces, todo esto es el progreso que nos ha ido ayudando, nos ha ido reflexionando, y el sector privado también ha reflexionado, porque ya los clientes son mucho más exigentes, la gente ya no solamente quiere creer en una cosa, como bien decían, hay algunos teatros a nivel mundial que no reciben donaciones del patrocinador si el patrocinador no tiene prácticas de gobierno corporativo estable, de ambientales y sociales. Entonces yo creo que en ese sentido el mundo sí está cambiando para un capitalismo, llamémoslo, pues gracias a los clientes y a los inversionistas, pues un poquito más social, más consciente. Y pues todos somos así. Ya hoy en día nadie puede sacar una empresa que no tenga eso, porque seguramente va a fracasar más rápido que una que no lo haga. Entonces yo creo que en ese sentido el mundo empresarial está no solamente haciéndolo, sino llevándolo a cabo. Obviamente que a nivel político y a nivel populista, pues es mucho más fácil exigirle a las empresas y no generarlas competencias y generar los espacios para que las empresas puedan competir mejor, para que las mismas empresas sean las conscientes y llevarlo a cabo. Y en ese sentido, pues nos estamos moviendo, pero yo creo que el mundo va hacia allá, el desarrollo empresarial va hacia un desarrollo mucho más, un capitalismo más humano, pero es un tema del cambio, del progreso, y no es un tema de que hay hoy en día una empresa, por pequeña o grande que sea, que dice, pues yo no hago las cosas como me está exigiendo la sociedad, porque pues se sale del mercado. Y yo creo que en ese sentido, pues nosotros en el Grupo Bolívar, pues venimos trabajando en eso desde hace 80 años, y yo creo que es parte del ADN nuestro, buscar que siempre haya un mayor desarrollo social y mejores beneficios para todos. Y si todos ganamos y tenemos un pastel aún más grande, pues claro, de golpe va a seguir habiendo una desigualdad, pero por lo menos vamos a tener todos más de dónde tomar.
Muchas gracias, Fernando. Y Juan Alonso, te digo la misma pregunta. ¿Existe mayor conciencia? ¿Cómo se experimenta esto desde la institución que dirige?
Sí, gracias Natalie, gracias al Global Leaders Program, a EOS, a Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda y al Banco de la República por la invitación. Sí, yo creo que como Fernando dice, tal vez la desigualdad social haya disminuido, pero para mí la brecha todavía sigue siendo enorme. Dice, sigue siendo enorme. El pastel se ha dividido de otra forma, pero las migas del pastel son las mismas por las que la gran mayoría de la población mundial se está peleando cada día, por esas migas y no por los trozos suculentos, ni mucho menos por la guinda. Yo como colombiano, emigrado de Europa desde mediados de los años 80, sí he visto evidentemente cambiar el mundo de la gestión cultural en forma radical, ¿no? En estos más de 30 años, y no solo en Europa, sino también en Colombia. Las dos fundaciones que ustedes presiden, mis compañeros aquí de panel, son un ejemplo de cómo ha cambiado todo esto, ¿no? En Colombia. Aquí, desde la Fundación Albéniz, que rige los destinos de la Escuela Reina Sofía, del Instituto de Música de Cámara de Madrid, como decían Natalia antes en la presentación, el Encuentro de Música y Academia de Santander y el Concurso de Piano de Santander Palomar, entre otros proyectos, se ha realizado desde sus inicios en los años 70 una gestión privada que persigue reunir a los más diversos miembros de la sociedad civil en torno a la educación y la cultura a través de la música, ¿no? Esta fue también la petición que nos hizo Su Majestad la Reina, Doña Sofía, al aceptar la presidencia de honor de esta institución, y era que representara los intereses de todos y estuviera abierta a la sociedad en su conjunto. Entonces, con esta bandera y con un producto de la mayor calidad pedagógica y artística posible, nos hemos dirigido a las empresas españolas de igual a igual, eso es importante, de igual a igual, seguros de que la importancia de nuestra labor dirigida al crecimiento de la educación musical en el país. Y actualmente tenemos más de 700 alumnos en las mejores orquestas, grupos de cámara, conservatorios, también muchos, muchos solistas que están representándonos en todos los continentes, realmente tenemos en todos los continentes. Tal vez estas sean las dos claves del éxito en las relaciones entre instituciones culturales desde mi punto de vista y las empresas. Empresas, como decíamos antes, como vimos en el panel anterior, empresas grandes y empresas pequeñas, incluso hasta el grupo de amigos que tiene la escuela, ¿no? De las personas que vienen aquí, se acercan a los conciertos y que también quieren apoyar de una forma u otra. Un producto de primerísima calidad y una buena propuesta de relación institucional con valores compartidos. No se trata de pedir una ayuda puntual a un proyecto, sino que por lo contrario, lo que más interesa a las empresas es una relación estable y duradera en donde se puedan ver reflejados sus propios valores fundacionales de calidad, excelencia y servicio social. Desde luego, las empresas están cada vez más concienciadas de la necesidad de tener un rol que va más allá de la generación de beneficios. Y esto incluye tener un rol relevante en la sociedad y atender a todos los grupos con los que se relacionan, sean sus empleados, accionistas, clientes, etcétera, ¿no? Así que apoyar proyectos sociales y educativos, en definitiva. Lo que sí vemos cada vez más es que estos proyectos tienen que estar alineados con los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible, los famosos ODS, y con los valores de la empresa. En nuestro caso, los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible a los que contribuimos junto con los mecenas que nos apoyan son la igualdad de oportunidades y la educación de calidad, entre otros. Por ejemplo, en la Escuela Reina Sofía representamos los valores de excelencia, innovación e inclusión, y hay muchas empresas que se identifican con esos valores. En los últimos 5 años, la Escuela Reina Sofía ha realizado un gran cambio en su gestión, precisamente para tener una imagen más abierta, una mayor proximidad con los intereses de nuestros mecenas, pero naturalmente sin perder las columnas fundamentales de nuestra institución, que son la formación musical de excelencia. Esto se debe también a que el perfil del músico profesional que solicitan las orquestas hoy en día también ha cambiado. Ya no es suficiente ser un gran intérprete y sentarse a esperar que le suene el teléfono invitándole a tocar en las mejores salas del mundo. Esto es pasado, esto ya no tiene nada que ver con la realidad. El músico del siglo XXI es un músico más cercano a su público, y a la sociedad en general. Ya no es ninguna excepción ver que un músico famoso crea una fundación para realizar proyectos de carácter social y educativo. Podemos perfectamente encontrarnos con un concierto de primerísima calidad en un hospital, en una cárcel, en una residencia de mayores, y ahí pueden estar tocando los mismos solistas que van a tocar por la noche al día siguiente en el Teatro de la Ópera o en el Auditorio Nacional. Creo francamente que en el ámbito de la repercusión de la música y su aspecto transformador en la sociedad, el sistema de orquestas de Venezuela que fundó el maestro José Antonio Abreu ha sido un punto de inflexión. Hay un antes, para mí, hay un antes y un después del sistema. Como todos sabemos, hoy en día este programa se ha reproducido en todo el mundo, adaptándolo a las necesidades específicas de cada continente. Son millares los jóvenes que han encontrado un lugar en su vida y en su comunidad a través de la música. Y no estamos hablando acá de pedagogía musical, sino del impacto social y de los valores que estos niños han recibido mediante la práctica de la música en grupo, con disciplina y con entusiasmo. Desde la escuela, nosotros hemos realizado proyectos conjuntos, por ejemplo, con los niños de Sinfonía por el Perú, que vinieron a Madrid hace un par de años, pero también estuvieron recibiendo clases online de nuestros alumnos y exalumnos durante todo este periodo de pandemia. Nuestros proyectos de emprendimiento han llegado a personas que forman parte de programas sociales dedicados a inmigrantes, víctimas de violencia de género, personas en peligro de exclusión social y muchos otros perfiles más que han podido aflorar sus sentimientos más reprimidos a través de la música. Muchos de ellos han... Perdón.
Sí, continúa.
Muchos de ellos, quería decir, han expresado abiertamente su agradecimiento a los jóvenes músicos que les han dedicado su tiempo y su arte con el único propósito de transmitir vida, alegría, amor y bondad. Sin embargo, ya para terminar, no todos son historias de éxito y quisiera poner acá sobre la mesa, si me lo permiten ustedes, una preocupación que tengo esta semana y es por una noticia que me ha llegado recientemente de Colombia. Y es la Orquesta Sinfónica Juvenil de Colombia, la de siempre, la del maestro Ernesto Díaz, la que se formó durante los años 70 y 80 y que ha formado más de 7.000 músicos profesionales colombianos, está al borde de ver su casa embargada y por ende pues de un cierre inminente. Entonces yo quisiera animar a los gestores culturales y a los empresarios colombianos que pudieran estar viendo esta conversación para que se preocupen por apoyar a una institución que, igual que el sistema de Venezuela, marcó a varias generaciones de jóvenes artistas en Colombia. Son muchísimos, muchísimos los jóvenes, los profesores profesionales de orquestas en el país que se formaron en esta institución. Y creo que es nuestro deber, y hay que agradecer a esta institución, y es nuestro deber apoyar a la que fue realmente la madre de todas las orquestas juveniles en Colombia. Así que pues ahí les dejo estas reflexiones y esta tarea a los que quieran coger el guante.
Gracias, Juan. Además que es muy interesante porque lo que traes a la mesa no es solo la responsabilidad social de las empresas, sino por supuesto la responsabilidad social de los artistas, que es lo que tenemos que vivir ahora y es la realidad. Aprovecho también el cambio para recordar a los participantes que pueden hacer sus preguntas a través del chat, todas las preguntas que quieran dirigir a nuestros tres panelistas y posteriormente procederemos a contestarlas. José Francisco, bienvenido. Te hago la misma pregunta. ¿Crees que existe una mayor conciencia y redireccionamiento de las empresas y cómo lo estás experimentando desde la Fundación Santo Domingo?
Bueno, un gusto saludarlos a todos. Es un placer y un honor estar con ustedes en esta conversación. Me parece una pregunta pues, muy relevante y muy importante para este momento. Desde la Fundación Santo Domingo, pues tenemos una experiencia bien interesante de 60 años como fundación familiar y empresarial. Yo veo que ha habido una evolución muy importante desde el concepto poco de la ciudadanía corporativa de las empresas, que empieza realmente en una evolución importante a final de los años 90 y con un crecimiento muy importante durante el comienzo del siglo de este siglo, en donde empieza a haber un crecimiento muy importante, digamos, de toda la tendencia de responsabilidad social empresarial, que evoluciona la creación de fundaciones empresariales y familiares en un auge importante a nivel global. Empiezan a crearse índices de sostenibilidad y de alguna forma a elevarse los estándares como se medían los resultados de una compañía, no simplemente desde la agregación de valor y la creación de capital para sus accionistas, sino realmente en una forma mucho más amplia como beneficio para sus grupos de interés. Y esto ha venido evolucionando en el tiempo con muchos conceptos, desde los temas de inversión de impacto, los temas de sostenibilidad, los conceptos de valor compartido, el crecimiento del movimiento de sistema B, las empresas B, y otra cantidad de índices y de estándares, además de tendencias y teorías que han llevado realmente a las compañías a pensar desde una óptica distinta y a los accionistas, a los dueños, a los empleados, a los ejecutivos de las empresas, a ver el rol de la empresa privada como un poco más extendido al tradicional de la operación de un negocio. Ese crecimiento, sin embargo, considero que aunque algunas compañías han sido vanguardistas, y resalto grupos como el Grupo Bolívar de Vivienda, que sigue, es un gran referente, digamos, en esa tendencia en Colombia y a nivel de Latinoamérica, pero no es el común denominador de lo que uno ve realmente en el sector empresarial. Y creo que estamos en un momento crucial donde toda esta pandemia llegó a mostrarnos un poco los desequilibrios existentes y de alguna forma hacer un llamado importante a una aceleración de esa evolución del concepto y del rol de la empresa privada. Un poco lo que estamos experimentando en este momento, y pienso que es algo global en donde los gobiernos empiezan a ver dificultades para, desde lo público, simplemente atender una pandemia sin crear unas recesiones económicas complejas, y donde el Estado va a verse impedido en poder hacer una reactivación económica eficiente sin poder tener un gran impulso del sector privado, pues lo que crea de alguna forma es como una especie de responsabilidad extendida de las empresas para poder, además de crecer estos negocios y mantener sus operaciones, generar el mayor beneficio social en las comunidades de influencia. Y creo que ahí está el reto más grande, porque aunque sí hay una mayor conciencia, no es fácil lograr que las compañías tengan la cultura, la estrategia y realmente la intención de crear ese valor adicional a la sociedad. Creo que además está generando un equilibrio un poco distinto, en donde hay que entender que los estados no son autosuficientes, y que la empresa privada tampoco va a poder por sí sola generar el valor económico y el impacto social. Y aquí tiene que haber una lógica mucho más de convergencia y de sinergia entre el sector público y privado para lograr realmente el desarrollo económico y social que uno quisiera ver. Un poco la lógica de el Estado hasta donde sea necesario y el mercado hasta donde sea posible, termina siendo muy relevante, pero sin duda en una lógica donde las dinámicas comerciales y de mercado hay que profundizarlas con conceptos y con un impacto social muy marcado. Y eso es un poco lo que desde la Fundación Santo Domingo hemos venido evolucionando en el transcurso de esta pandemia. ¿Cómo logramos una coordinación de un gran grupo empresarial centralizado en unos conceptos de impacto social a través de la fundación, logrando colectivamente proponernos unos objetivos empresariales más unos objetivos de impacto social e incluso ambiental para lograr unas apuestas de largo plazo sostenibles, digamos, dentro de una lógica integral de impacto desde lo económico, lo social y lo ambiental, en coordinación con múltiples actores de la sociedad civil, del sector empresarial y del Estado, tanto a nivel nacional como a nivel regional. Ese ha sido un poco como el enfoque, y vemos un reto grandísimo en lograr realmente que el sector empresarial logre una mayor conciencia, pero realmente una mayor implementación de estas lógicas de capitalismo consciente, como Fernando lo resaltaba.
José Francisco, y esto que mencionas como de una responsabilidad extendida con el Estado, dentro de la actividad de la empresa, ¿cuál consideras que sería el valor que genera para las empresas cuando se comprometen de una manera más profunda en resolver estos retos sociales?
Pues es que es muy difícil que una compañía sea próspera, rentable y sostenible en el tiempo si su entorno no lo es, si sus grupos de interés no están en las mejores condiciones posibles. Entonces, creo que es un círculo virtuoso. En la medida en que estas compañías aportan a generar un mayor desarrollo social, una mejor sostenibilidad ambiental, a cuidar sus entornos y a generar valor de forma integrada a sus diferentes grupos de interés, pues los van a ver en sus resultados de corto, mediano y largo plazo de una forma, digamos, mucho, mucho más clara. En la medida que esto no se dé, con esta profundización, por ejemplo, de una crisis económica como resultado de la pandemia, en los entornos donde las compañías operan y en los mercados que atienden, si estamos en recesión económica y en entornos complejos de pobreza y desigualdad, pues la competitividad y productividad de las compañías se va a ver directamente afectada. Y creemos claramente en ese equilibrio y no es posible que la empresa lo haga solo. Por eso, tanto las políticas de Estado como las alianzas interinstitucionales y sectoriales terminan siendo claves. Y creo que un poco lo que nos ha mostrado la pandemia es que hay unas formas de colaboración y unas posibilidades de trabajo conjunto que antes eran más difíciles de lograr. Y eso creo que ha sido un aprendizaje importante porque se ha dado, al menos a nivel Colombia, lo hemos visto también en otras redes a nivel internacional, en donde se evidencia que hay unas experiencias muy interesantes de colaboración entre fundaciones, empresa privada, gobiernos, para lograr unos objetivos comunes que eran muy difíciles de lograr de una forma individual.
Sí, gracias, José Francisco. Fernando, ¿tú nos puedes dar algunos ejemplos de estas alianzas estratégicas de éxito, cómo las empresas adoptando esta cultura de responsabilidad social y sostenibilidad generan alianzas con otros actores de la sociedad?
Claro, pues digamos que yo creo que hoy en día las alianzas y la co-creación y el desarrollo, ya sea de valor, y tú lo decías bien, el valor compartido, pues está todos los días en mayor auge. Entonces tú tienes que estar buscando este tipo de alianzas para desarrollar diferentes modelos de valor. Y te pongo ejemplos como, por ejemplo, para no ser directamente, por ejemplo, en el Grupo Bolívar, todos los corresponsales bancarios que le llegan a millones de colombianos en la ruralidad, pues no son directamente empleados nuestros, son proveedores nuestros que nosotros hacemos alianzas para que ellos puedan llegar y sostener su negocio y poderlo llevar a cabo. Entonces, ese es un ejemplo pues muy bonito porque le llega a muchísima gente ese desarrollo. También está el tema de, digamos, nosotros tenemos una alianza con Rappi para poder desarrollar nuevos productos. Rappi es, para los que no sé si aquí están todos son colombianos en el panel, pero Rappi es una empresa colombiana que hace como domicilios a través de una plataforma web. Pero en ese sentido, la alianza con Rappi es nosotros ser el banco, el back office de banco y de uso de tarjetas de crédito que tiene Rappi. Entonces, en ese sentido, pues uno tiene generándole un valor a los clientes, a los beneficiarios. Y en temas de responsabilidad social también uno ve, por ejemplo, todos los apoyos que hemos hecho al transcurso de la vida del grupo en apoyar diferentes temas culturales, artísticos, editoriales. Por ejemplo, hoy acabamos de sacar un libro se llama Las Hijas del Agua, de Rubén Afanador y de Ana González, en donde lo que nosotros buscamos es una alianza con ellos para llevarle a Colombia y a los colombianos la importancia de lo que es las etnias originarias de regiones como el Chiribiquete, que es un parque nacional realmente que creo que 100 personas no lo conocen en Colombia porque pues no hemos tenido la oportunidad de ir debido al conflicto, que ahora sí vamos a poder empezar a disfrutar. Y en ese sentido, pues este tipo de alianzas empezamos a transformar un poco lo que es el desarrollo ambiental, social, de poder lograr llegar a muchos lugares y a muchos clientes y a muchas personas que antes no tenían esa posibilidad. Y yo creo que de esa manera, pues, la manera de crecerse está cambiando a nivel de empresas. Las empresas también estamos viendo que es muy importante desarrollar beneficios para todos en buscar opciones para que las personas no solamente, por ejemplo, en temas de empleo. Entonces hacemos alianzas con el ICETEX, hacemos alianzas con el SENA, se hacen alianzas con las universidades, se hacen alianzas y co-creaciones también con universidades para desarrollar innovación. En ese sentido, pues todo eso empieza a fortalecer el tema. De hecho, tenemos una alianza muy valiosa con la Fundación Albeniz y la Escuela de Música Reina Sofía para promover el desarrollo musical de los jóvenes. Hacemos alianzas también con empresas, pues no empresas, con organizaciones que fomentan el desarrollo musical en regiones apartadas que a través de la Filarmónica Joven de Colombia, nosotros con Elena Barreto y Juan Andrés Rojas, que dirigen el programa, pues estamos llegando pues, a muchísimos niños que no tendrían la oportunidad. Y todo esto se hace generando que se genere un valor. No estoy diciendo un modelo de negocio, no, un modelo de valor, porque si no hay un modelo de valor, pues el proyecto es insostenible. Y ese es uno de los problemas que tenemos muchísimas veces con las organizaciones sociales, y es que no generan un modelo de valor o no pueden concentrarse en generar un modelo de valor para que alguien esté dispuesto de aportar, ya sean entes multilaterales, ya sea el gobierno, ya sea el gobierno local, ya sean entidades, empresas. Y en ese sentido, pues parte del foco que nosotros estamos también tratando de construir en la fundación es generar que las organizaciones sociales puedan lograr llegar a tener eso. Tenemos un programa de este programa precisamente, el Global Leadership Program de la Orquesta de las Américas, es un programa creado precisamente para darle no solamente oportunidades a los músicos como músicos, sino oportunidades como emprendedores. Y en ese sentido, ese tipo de alianzas que tiene la OA con las diferentes universidades, pues todo eso genera un valor que los músicos van a aprovechar y disfrutar, y ojalá que sean exitosos. Entonces, en ese sentido, hoy en día, pues ejemplos, uno puede empezar a enumerar una cantidad de ejemplos en todo esto, pero yo creo que es una manera de hoy en día generar valor, y es que lo que hablaban en el panel anterior, el valor compartido ya es un tema que tenemos que hacer entre todos, que todo el mundo tenemos que estar generando este valor para que todo el mundo pueda participar en el desarrollo de proyectos y generar ese valor para la sociedad y para todos.
Sí, muy bien. Juan, hablando desde esta perspectiva del valor, de ese valor que se genera entre los dos lados, tú desde el otro lado, desde la escuela, por ejemplo, ¿cuáles son las mejores prácticas para las instituciones para asegurar este tipo de relaciones a largo plazo con las empresas? ¿O de qué manera crees que deben reinventarse las instituciones como la escuela o instituciones sin ánimo de lucro para generar relaciones, este tipo de relaciones, relaciones a largo plazo, sólidas, que generen valor con distintos patrocinadores o inversores?
Pues sí, realmente Fernando y José Francisco me han puesto los temas justo en bandeja de plata, porque en la escuela tenemos ya muchas empresas, ¿no?, que nos acompañan hace muchos años, desde la fundación de la escuela hace 30 años, y se ha creado una relación tal que ya no son, o sea, que no solamente están muy cercanos al desarrollo de los alumnos o a los grupos de cámara que llevan su nombre y que patrocinan, sino que también siguen muy de cerca las carreras profesionales de los exalumnos, ya una vez terminan en la escuela, ¿no? Y están muy pendientes. Nuestra relación con Colombia, por ejemplo, evidentemente contamos con estas dos instituciones, la Fundación Bolívar de Vivienda y la Fundación Santo Domingo, con las que, de las que ya se han beneficiado más de una veintena de jóvenes artistas colombianos. Por ejemplo, la Filarmónica Joven, como decía Fernando, ha hecho posible que algunos de sus músicos de sus filas hayan podido realizar estudios aquí de título superior o de máster en interpretación, y les hemos dado también cursos de emprendimiento cultural en la escuela. Al mismo tiempo, los alumnos tienen el compromiso de regresar a Colombia para hacer allá actuaciones y proyectos que beneficien a la comunidad de la cual proceden. Y con la Fundación Santo Domingo, igualmente apoyando con becas completas a cantantes instrumentistas colombianos, muchos de ellos ya, o sea, ya son nombres que forman parte de los carteles, por ejemplo, de la Ópera de Colombia. Y cada año, aprovechando las vacaciones del verano nuestras, el Teatro Mayor Santo Domingo acoge en agosto un concierto de jóvenes talentos de la Escuela Reina Sofía, en donde estos muchachos colombianos pues pueden mostrar su talento y la evolución artística en el auditorio en Bogotá. Yo creo que la clave de las alianzas tal vez estaría en estos puntos. Primero, identificar las sinergias, ¿no? O sea, que hay entre nuestros proyectos para construir juntos, ¿no? Y que tengan un sentido para ambas partes. no se trata solo de fomentar el desarrollo profesional de los músicos, sino también concienciarles sobre el rol que pueden tener en la sociedad como agentes de cambio. Esto lo hacemos por parte de la escuela, como decía antes, ofreciendo a nuestros alumnos un programa de emprendimiento, innovación social, que les da las herramientas necesarias para poder concebir, planificar y llevar a cabo sus propios proyectos. Luego, la flexibilidad y la confianza. Una relación consolidada es aquella en la cual nos comunicamos mucho, volviendo al caso de las fundaciones, ¿no?, de Santo Domingo y Bolívar, la vivienda, para que estén siempre informados de los avances de los alumnos que ellos becan, y buscamos oportunidades de revertir el país y la participación de los chicos en conciertos allá. Porque cuando tú tienes un mecenas que está al día con su aporte, cuando tienes un mecenas que está al día con su aporte de pagos, por decirlo así, pero no se interesa en lo más mínimo en las actividades que le propones, ni tampoco pregunta por el desarrollo de sus becados, ahí es donde tienes un problema. Porque el ideal es despertar el interés del mecenas, lógicamente, por cómo se desarrollan sus pupilos. Y no me refiero aquí solamente al interés del presidente de la empresa, sino pues que aquí tenemos muchos casos, muchos ejemplos de gente, de trabajadores de empresas vinculadas a la escuela, que aparte de los conciertos que les dedicamos a ellos como compañía, asisten con regularidad a todos nuestros ciclos y actividades de la escuela, y aprovechan nuestra oferta cultural, traen a sus familias y están muy cercanos a los músicos que ya conocen, porque son representantes de su marca, ¿no? La flexibilidad es muy importante porque, sobre todo en estos momentos en que ya nada es como antes, nosotros no hemos parado de hacer conciertos, es muy importante para la educación de los muchachos. Por supuesto, estamos abiertos a las propuestas y acciones que nos proponen los mecenas, porque también es educativo para los alumnos ver este tipo de perspectivas desde la empresa. Y el artista actual debe tener una mente abierta, simplemente tenemos que impulsarles a estos jóvenes a que su creatividad pues la lleven a cabo, que puedan crear, puedan hacer todas las ideas y llevarlas a cabo, y porque no hay límites realmente al poder comunicador y transformador de la música, como ya sabemos. Algo interesante también es la propia composición del equipo de dirección de las instituciones culturales. Nosotros aquí en la escuela somos un equipo de dirección con perfiles, como se dice ahora, híbridos, unos del sector artístico y otros del mundo empresarial. Y esto consolida la institución a la hora de establecer colaboraciones con empresas. Compartimos puntos de vista muy distintos, que aportan la visión artística y educativa, pero que también la del simple espectador interesado en música, que puede tener unas expectativas diferentes al asistir a un concierto que las de un músico profesional. En nuestro caso, hemos descubierto que la música se puede compartir de múltiples formas, no solamente a través del formato tradicional de concierto. Los coros, por ejemplo, de las empresas han actuado con nuestros alumnos. Los formatos de narraciones pedagógicas para alumnos de colegios o para grupos de familias, que son realmente la base de que podamos contar con un público el día de mañana, ¿no? Los niños, la formación de los niños y atraerlos a la música, al amor por la música. El papel de liderazgo del director de orquesta, que bien se puede explicar a los directivos de las empresas, al ponerles al frente de una orquesta a dirigir, algo a lo que no están acostumbrados, ven de manera directa cómo su discurso, incluso su movimiento, su comportamiento, Natalie se ríe, el comportamiento, pues se ve cómo la gente reacciona, ¿no? Es un equipo que está reaccionando a las directrices de este director, que en la empresa es el gerente o el jefe de departamento o quien sea, ¿no?
Y Juan, lo siento que tengo que interrumpirte porque tenemos 2 minutos para cerrar esta muy interesante, me cuesta mucho interrumpir a cualquiera de los tres, para que podamos tener una pregunta del público. Juan Andrés, te doy paso para que en un minuto resolvamos una pregunta del público.
Dale, Natalie, muchas gracias. Hola a todos, gracias por acompañarnos. La pregunta es de Ellen Restrepo, de la Sinfónica de Antioquia, y es, ahorita José Francisco hablaba de cómo lograr una colectividad entre el sector empresarial que pudiera permitir como ese tejido social, y digamos que la inquietud que nos hacemos desde el sector es, claro, las grandes empresas ya tienen una cultura de responsabilidad social, de apoyo al arte, a la cultura, de vínculo con la academia. ¿cómo participarían y cuál sería ese rol justamente de la academia y del sector artístico en contribuir a esa estrategia de cada vez atraer más empresas, no solo los grandes grupos, sino también las empresas que hoy no tienen esa cultura de apoyo al sector artístico? Entonces, en un minuto, pues cada uno, es la propuesta, ¿cómo resolvería este tema? ¿Cómo la academia y el sector artístico pueden hacer parte de esta construcción de generar más atractividad en la estrategia de responsabilidad social del sector privado?
Pues como yo lo veo, es como una gran oportunidad en realidad para las industrias creativas y culturales. En la evolución del sector empresarial, cada vez más ve uno la cabida del sector creativo y cultural, y sin duda el académico. Particularmente en Colombia se están gestando leyes para impulsar lo que el gobierno ha denominado la economía naranja. Y en ese sector creo que es muy importante entender que la cultura es un motor real de transformación social. Y al menos desde el grupo empresarial y desde la Fundación Santo Domingo, estamos dándole un gran impulso a este tema, no solamente con la alianza con la Fundación Albeniz o con lo que hacemos en el Teatro Mayor Julio Mario Santo Domingo, en la Escuela de Artes y Oficios, son otra serie de proyectos culturales y de industrias creativas, porque creemos que es a través de la promoción de este tipo de talento y del fomento de estas industrias en donde realmente logramos llegar a la base cultural de la población, y de ahí se generan unas transformaciones muy relevantes. Entonces, siendo muy concreto, considero que ese es un sector que puede tener la posibilidad de influenciar e incidir en el desarrollo de otros sectores, y que adicionalmente tiene un potencial de generar un impacto sustancialmente mayor en la cultura y en la transformación social hacia ese capitalismo consciente que estábamos hablando y de alguna forma como incentivando al comienzo de la conversación.
Gracias, Fernando. Si lo puedes contestar en 30 segundos, por favor, y Juan, que estamos pasados de tiempo.
En un segundo, estoy de acuerdo con José.
Muy bien.
Pero yo creo que una de las cosas que, pues, viniendo a la pregunta de Juan Andrés, es nosotros, cuando nosotros pues, nos montamos en el proyecto de la Filarmónica Joven de Colombia, es uno montarse en todos los problemas que tiene el sector cultural. Las cosas buenas y las cosas malas. Y en ese sentido yo creo que uno tiene que estar consciente e innovando de cómo llegarle a la mayor cantidad de personas. ¿Qué nos pasa muchas veces? Nos quedamos enfocados que hay 5 patrocinadores y a esos 5 patrocinadores cada día le cobramos más. Y yo creo que tenemos que buscar la manera de reducir ese valor de ingreso a buscar patrocinadores más pequeños. Y aprovecho y le doy un gran saludo a Helen, que la estimo y la admiro muchísimo. Porque yo creo que a través de uno ver cómo le llega a uno más gente, pues uno puede lograr llegar a también tener una mayor base. Y en ese sentido, pues yo creo que tenemos que trabajar. Obviamente que la pregunta no es fácil, porque si la tuviera la respuesta a la bala de oro, pues yo creo que no estaríamos ni siquiera en este panel. Pero ofrecemos y qué valor damos y a quién se lo ofrecemos para que todos podamos participar de la transformación cultural.
Juan, 30 segundos.
Sí,
muchas 30 gracias.
Segundos. Yo creo que lo importante es que la relación y el proyecto en sí, la concepción del proyecto, sea finalmente un win-win, como se dice ahora, ¿no? Que todos salgan ganando, todos los implicados salen ganando, tanto los accionistas, empleados de las empresas, las familias. Es muy importante pensar en las familias de los empleados de las empresas. Y por el lado del artista, pues el artista que descubra ese poder transformador y ese servicio que él puede dar a la sociedad a través de la música, de su arte, que muchas veces como intérprete o como que se encierra uno en su casillero a tocar o detrás del piano se esconde, ni siquiera se lo ha pensado, ¿no? Ese poder que tiene la música.
Gracias. Bueno, con esto cerramos entonces. Muchísimas gracias a todos por este panel tan interesante y espero que estén muy bien en estos días, que estén seguros. Hasta luego. Chao.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias. Abrazos a todos en Colombia.
Juan Alonso, chao José, chao, gracias, gracias Natalí. Chao.